Welcome to the 2021 Buffalo Music Hall of Fame induction. I'm Janice Mitchell, class of 2000. For the next 60 minutes, we'll introduce you to some of Western New York's finest and most memorable musicians. Our first trio of inductees in the class of 2021 are true masters and world-class musicians whose music has been heard in some of the most recognizable movies, soundtracks, and recordings of our time. Steve Pfister is a brilliant LA-based solo guitarist and platinum recording artist whose music has been heard on HBO, MTV, VH1, Showtime, and movies. Junie Booth was a versatile and widely renowned force on both the acoustic and electric bass. He was internationally known in the jazz world and a true master of his instrument. And Edie Lehman Boddicker is one of LA's busiest session singers whose career spans the globe and has worked on hundreds of feature films, recordings, and television shows.
Edie Lehman Boddicker. Her lengthy and ongoing career includes contracting, conducting, and consulting on hundreds of feature films, commercials, recordings, and television shows. Her work spans the globe, but her music roots began right here in Buffalo.
When I was about three, we moved to Grand Island. And on Grand Island, my mom, in the basement of my third year, the basement of our house, she taught myself and my two older brothers the notes all at the same time. And so at the age of four, they sent me to a piano teacher who was one of the premier teachers in the East, also the piano teacher for Leonard Panario, who is an amazing concert pianist that also came from Buffalo, was also a Buffalo Music Hall of Fame recipient. he's an amazing pianist. And I started with her at the age of four, and I was playing in Klein Hans Music Hall when I was about six or seven, and I just took to the piano.
She has worked on films like Dune, The Lion King, La La Land, and Happy Feet.
Because I didn't know she was from Buffalo. She started to bring in these singers, and I just was introduced basically to the creme de la creme of Los Angeles singers. But Edie herself, I didn't quite realize what a sort of a musical talent she was until we started to work together. So, I mean, a very charitable person, but also a brilliant, you know, an asset. I mean, that's the thing is that, I mean, I love her as a person, but boy, have I had a great asset because of her, the way she kind of thinks and the way she is.
Edie has worked with top recording artists that include Shawn Menendez, Justin Timberlake, Katy Perry, Harry Styles, and The Weeknd. She's recorded numerous classic albums with Aretha Franklin, Madonna, Thomas Dolby, Linda Ronstadt, and she's also worked with Billie Eilish and Alicia Keys. Edie has also contributed to Jimmy Kimmel Live, American Idol, the Grammys, and the Oscars.
I think it was a DreamWorks thing we were doing at the Hollywood Bowl, and Edie was sort of in charge of vocals, and she wasn't just in charge of vocals, she was in charge of us. She was the most helpful, most conscientious, wisest, best musician that we could surround ourselves with. We did the Oscars together with Pharrell. We did the Grammys together with Pharrell. We've been touring together. And then finally, I think we did the Lion King together. So. We've done a few things, but I think sort of the high point in our sort of creative relationship really, I think, has to be Dune. But I can look over to Edie and everything will be fine. Everything, you know, there's a sense of solidity and professionalism and a heart that is massive. And it's that heart that I think is just as important as her intellect.
No matter where Edie's work takes her, Buffalo is still top of mind for her.
The fact that Buffalo is now kind of becoming more and more visible as an immigrant city is huge. This is where we got our start. And my father was hugely instrumental in bringing in over 200 immigrants and sponsoring them and finding them jobs. And they would live, many of them would live in our home until they got their own places. And many of them were the artisans and the craftsmen that built Grand Island. We are the immigrants that then become lovers of the people of Buffalo and love America, because Buffalo was our landing spot. This is where we landed.
So grateful to the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame for this honor. Thank you again for recognizing my parents' wonderful gift to Buffalo in terms of the immigrant community and also in terms of teaching me everything I know. Thankful for this industry that lets me be as big as I can be. It doesn't care that I'm a woman, because I don't, because I just am going to be big, I don't care. And then I'm also a Molnar, which also means I'm going to be big. And then above all, I give glory to God for the rich experiences that I've had and continue to have. And I bless you all.
A master jazz bassist and international world-class musician, Junie Booth was a versatile and widely renowned force on both the acoustic and electric bass, playing both traditional and contemporary jazz.
He played with older guys like Coleman Hawkins from the swing era, and then he was playing with younger musicians from like the, you know, Ornette Coleman kind of school of free jazz, and he had to straddle that line between both worlds, which to me is what gave Junie such an interesting approach to music.
His recording and performing credits read like a who's who of jazz greats, spanning the spectrum of jazz styles, beginning when Junie was still in high school. Junie was best known for his work with pianist McCoy Tyner, with whom he recorded three albums for Milestone Records, Enlightenment, Song of the New World, and Atlantis.
I went to New York, played with Art Blakey, but almost immediately got associated with the avant-garde scene and made a couple albums, 66, 67, 68, with those people. As he was doing that, he was making connections with bigger name artists. And so by 70, 71, 72, he was playing with McCoy Tyner, Freddie Hubbard, Tony Williams, and a lot of other people that are in that circle.
Junie also performed with Chuck Mangione, Gary Bartz, Steve Grossman, Elvin Jones, Coleman Hawkins, and many more all-time jazz greats.
He wasn't your average player. He was a world-class player. He deserved every accolade that was available from anyone who understood the genre. He was particularly strong on his axe. And again, had a voice that was very unique to him. And God bless his soul. He deserves every positive thing that can be said about him for the rest of time.
Steve Pfister is the kind of guitarist that can make the instrument sing.
One of the things with him is that it's as if, like, his heart comes right through the guitar.
Steve grew up in Cheektowaga, began making records and performing at the age of 7, and started playing guitar in clubs at the age of 12, taking advantage of a vibrant Buffalo music scene.
You could walk into any place in Buffalo and hear somebody just tearing it up. And that was, look at what we had. You could go into a club and see Talas. You could see all these great bands. And everybody, you know, that was the work ethic and the presentation that I learned when I came here.
At just 17 years old, Steve left for L.A., applying that Buffalo work ethic. Along with his raw talent, he soon caught the attention of music royalty.
The first tour, when I was pretty young, was with the Iron Butterfly. And it was the original guys and me. And there he had some problems with their guitar player. And I learned the stuff. And next thing you know, we're out on a tour with Grand Funk Railroad, Leslie West, and Savoy Brown.
He has recorded and performed with the likes of Quiet Riot, Pat Travers, Poison, Tommy Two Tone, and Steppenwolf, and found himself playing in iconic venues like Wembley Stadium.
I was with Lita Ford, and we were on a Bon Jovi tour, which was huge. And what a great moment from that whole thing was that John always invited me up to play with them, and one night I was playing with Elton John and Brian May, and that was a huge thrill. And forgive me for the name dropping, but I suppose that's what this is for.
Steve has been called a masterful solo artist, a brilliant guitarist, with soul in his fingers and heart in his songs. His music has been heard on HBO, MTV, VH1, Showtime, in movies and elsewhere. And as a platinum recording artist, has produced numerous solo records heard worldwide. With a blues rock sound and a giving spirit, Steve shares his talents, teaching guitar to others. And through all of his success, Steve has remained humble and kind. Not fall down.
They say home is where the heart is. And for these class of 2021 inductees, no matter how far their career has taken them, they never forget their Buffalo roots. We'll meet our next inductees after the break.
Welcome back to the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame Class of 2021 Induction Special. My name is Anthony Casuccio. Some of you may be wondering, what is the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame? Our mission is to properly honor the diverse musical talent that has flourished in the Western New York area. Through the years, the Hall of Fame has honored some of the most amazing talent this area, this country, and even the world has ever known. They have been Grammy winners and Academy Award winners, soundtrack composers that have put the music to our favorite movies, musicals, and TV shows, producers and engineers that have helped craft the hit songs of generations. As long as we can get lost in the melody of a magnificent symphony, a brilliant blues bass master, a hot rocker, or a keyboard virtuoso. As long as music lifts our hearts and inspires our souls, the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame will continue its noble mission of preserving our musical heritage. With over 300 inductees and counting, the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame will continue to grow, and the Western New York area will always pay homage to the men and women who have traveled over the rainbow, have found better days, and know that happy days are here again. And if you do not recognize these song titles, visit our website at buffalomusichalloffame.org to learn more about our inductees. This year, we are celebrating our 40th anniversary of honoring Western New York's musical best. We'll be having an all-star concert on September 17th at Sportsman's Park, as well as various events throughout the summer and fall. So please check our website for details. Now let's send it back over to our host, Janice Mitchell.
Our next three inductees exude Buffalo love. Robin Grandin is a powerhouse singer-songwriter and Nashville recording artist that has made her way back to Western New York after years of touring throughout the U.S. and Canada to play it forward in her hometown community. Bob Leatherbarrow is an L.A.-based live performance and studio drummer whose music you may have heard on many film and television soundtracks. He still calls Buffalo his home. And Scott Salaney is a Western New York recording artist whose inspiration and passion is all about his music, his hometown, and family.
But if it's a crowd that's engaged and is really enjoying it, and you can see them singing the songs back to you and they're having a good time, there is no high like it. You know?
Scott Salaney has been performing live to appreciative crowds for more than 20 years. Songs like Christmas by the Lake, one of the most requested songs on local radio during the Christmas season for 17 years now. His talents recognized by acclaimed vocal coach Jan Smith, who Scott trained with while living in Atlanta. Smith has chaired the Atlanta chapter of the Grammys and has worked with the likes of Usher, Rob Thomas, and Justin Bieber. Scott Salaney does it all, originals, covers, but there was always that pull for family, for Buffalo. Something about performing in his hometown.
There's live music in every city, but not every city has what Buffalo has, not just in terms of music, but the arts in general. It's a great music town, and it's a great music community.
In fact, that helped inspire his most successful recording to date, Home. It hit number 4 on the Global Digital Independent chart.
It was about, you know, wanting to be around the people that matter the most. It was about my family, and we made the video about, like, because the video had a different concept to begin with. And I said, you know what, this needs to be about family.
We're blessed with talent, and if we can use it for a good force, then we should.
And Scott does, using his talents to make a positive impact on the community.
But he was always thinking of opportunities and how to network and bring people together and partner. He's a great partnering guy.
Helping out with the Chicken Wing Fest, Rock for Food for the Food Bank, and the charity he began with his wife Mary, Totally Buffalo.
The charity can pivot a lot. Whenever we find a need, we address it.
It also celebrates the talents of all kinds of artists locally when they opened up 2 stores to provide a space for those in them to sell their creations, supporting the local art scene.
I mean, you look around the stores and know what I see? I don't see Buffalo stuff. I see artists that get given opportunities.
For Scott Salaney, one inspiration is constant. Family.
Well, you see how it changes people, and, you know, it changes them for the better. I think we all have a natural empathy gene. I think that tends to kick in even more when you become a parent. So it's nice to see that. And he really does care about the girls.
Scott Salaney continues to inspire through his music, his charitable work, and his most important role, Dad.
I don't care how much it cost me, this empty road has finally lost me, and I just want to come home to you.
Bob Leatherbarrow. A top live performance and studio drummer in L.A., Bob has played with an extensive list of great jazz artists. Ernie Watts Quartet, Joe Farrell, Peggy Lee, Victor Feldman, Horace Silver, Doc Severinsen, Jack Sheldon, Rosemary Clooney, Natalie Cole, and Mike Barone's Big Band.
I started taking drum lessons from my Uncle Charlie, and they knew right away that I loved it. I took to it, I was a natural to it, and I just took it very seriously and went for it. And that's from then on, that's what I did. You know, studio musicians aren't particularly famous. I didn't play to become famous. I played because I loved music. I wanted to be a professional musician like my uncle was, and I was more interested in being great at it than being famous. I figured if people are going to know about me, that's going to take care of itself. You know?
Bob Leatherbarrow may live, work, and literally play in L.A., but he will be the first to tell you Buffalo is home sweet home.
Yeah. Buffalo's great. The people are wonderful. It was a beautiful place to grow up. I think the people in Buffalo are really, really nice people. you know, and a lot of great musicians in Buffalo too. I was lucky to play with lots of great people there, and I learned a lot doing it, you know. And the thing I was able to do back in the day that I don't know if you can do now is that I got to play from a very young age, you know, from like when I was like 14 years old or something. I was playing professionally. Charlie took me on some jobs, and then I found some other people that would hire me. And, you know, I get to play at these places and play professionally, play all different kinds of music and play for people and learn a lot. And I was a good kid, so I'd shut my mouth. I would drink 7-Up and, you know, they wouldn't, you know. So it was great. It was great. And I got to learn things that I don't know if kids get to learn now.
Bob respects this town. He knows the people here. He knows the musicians here. At one time I asked him to take a look through the list of inductees to the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame. And he says, you know, I know all these guys. I know them. I played with most of them. I'm friends with most of them. I respect the talent that's in this town. I said, Bob, you belong in the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame.
So Bobby's one of the very, very most talented guys that's come out of this town. And he's also a good businessman.
He has recorded with artists from Gordon Lightfoot to Bette Midler and Dolly Parton, from Placido Domingo to Henry Mancini. You've heard him on film and television soundtracks, including The Simpsons, Family Guy, American Dad, The Cleveland Show, King of the Hill, Austin Powers, and Bruce Almighty.
And being not only a jazz improviser, but in a recording musician, it's a very high pressure situation. You need to be great every time you play. And, you know, I think the guitarist Pat Metheny said it really great. He said, we have to be comfortable being uncomfortable. You know what I mean? So you don't know what's going to happen until you play. And you don't know what music you're going to play until you walk in the room. I mean, every time I go on one of those Family Guy or Simpsons dates or something, we don't know what we're going to play until we get there. They stick the book in front of us. We open it. You know, we get a run through and we take it. You know, so we got to read that. We got to read that stuff. We got to know what to play. And for the percussion, it can be pretty high pressure, especially like on the Simpsons. Boy, sometimes I'm playing 3-4 instruments in one cue, but it's high pressure. It's, you know, one of my buddies called it studio work. He said, well, it was about 80% routine and 20% sheer terror.
Bobby is one of those guys that just constantly feeds you new information without being boisterous or being overwhelming. He's like the perfect drummer.
When he uses his drum set talks. And I don't know where he learned how to play vibraphone, but when he plays the vibes, it sings. Bob is the consummate musician. He can be professional and he's humble at the same time.
That way, for me, it's about the music, not about me. I didn't do this to make myself a star, because I wouldn't have played the drums, first of all. I'd been a singer or something.
Robin Grandin. Singer, songwriter, and instrumentalist, she made her mark in playing in Western New York bands including Pepperwood Green, Clockworks, Ice Nine, Songbird, Prime Suspect, and The Touch. She toured the U.S. and Canada and represented General Motors at the Texas State Fair with the band Rainbow.
I went on the road with Rainbow in the late 80s, and I found a love for playing in front of audiences all over the United States and Canada. From there, I ended up moving to Nashville, Tennessee. When you play music, your soul is exposed.
Her Nashville band Hurricane Jane was signed to an indie record deal, Rotation Records, and she was one of the founding members of Mustang Sally.
Once the music starts, that's when the magic happens. And the magic is a communication that is unlike any other.
She opened for country legends George Jones, Patti Loveless, Lori Morgan, Delbert McClinton, Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, and so many more.
You know, with every experience that you play on stage, you learn. And that's what I took from that. I always learned. I learned, what kind of songs are they writing? What kind of songs can I write? And it was just a great experience, especially in my experience to stand next to the late and great Mr. George Jones and have him put his arm around me and look at me and go, yeah.
Your Robin has such a passion for music. It's undeniable.
But I have to say, one of my most important accomplishments to date has got to be playing for Alzheimer's, dementia, and veterans, and families, and all of these patients that need music in their life. And I feel like I'm able to help in some way to make their lives just a little bit happier, a little bit brighter, and maybe to spread a little of that music magic their way.
She has released 4 albums and has written hundreds of original songs to date, including co-writing Round and Round on WPHD Homegrown Album Volume 3, and the single Memories of the Heart, the inspiration for Music to Remember, a partnered program of the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame.
Robin wrote this incredibly beautiful song and gifted not just Park Creek and not just you with this song, but the world with that song. I knew that Robin, with this song, understood the journey that everybody who has someone who has memory impairment in their life, she knew the journey and she expressed it in song. And that is incredibly powerful, that somebody understands what people are going through.
This could be the very beginning of a legacy. I have created the Music to Remember non-for-profit, and we bring a lot of musicians to a lot of different senior facilities. And you know what? This could go on for years and years, as long as the music lasts.
As somebody who loves music, and for somebody who is so empowered by this one mission, you can see how strong Robin is by the work that she's doing. There's no better performance that you could go to support a better cause than to see Robin perform and just how much fun she's having.
Welcome back. My name is Tom Lorenz. I'm the Vice President of the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame. For more than a decade, the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame has presented young, talented musicians with scholarship awards for their outstanding accomplishments. Our exciting scholarship program opportunities encourage and mentor talented young musicians as they pursue careers in music and follow their musical dreams. The Buffalo Music Hall of Fame Education Scholarship recognizes outstanding high school seniors, grade 12, who will be studying music, business of music, music therapy, or any technical, audio, or production aspect of music in college. Special recipients will be chosen each year to receive our special scholarship awards. The Lucille and Jack Yellen Foundation, in collaboration with the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame, has been mentoring and awarding young amateur songwriters between the ages of 13 and 18 since 2013. These budding young songwriters are given the chance to have one of their original song compositions take center stage. The winning songwriter will receive a cash prize and be showcased at various Buffalo Music Hall of Fame concert events. Community. On any given day throughout the year, the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame presence can be heard all across Western New York. Under the umbrella of Hall of Fame Heels, our trio of partnered programs, Music to Remember Western New York, Bridges Battle, and Western New York Drummers for Homeless People, have joined together to expand their reach to more of the community by bringing the healing power of music to Western New York. Our connection with the community continues throughout the year. with performances at the Juneteenth Festival of Buffalo. The Unity Band, which is a class of 2003, is always one of the highlights of this great parade and event. We also fill the summer air with music in the heart of downtown Buffalo. The M&T Bank Plaza Events Series brings music fans 11 weeks of great outdoor concerts, featuring some of Buffalo's finest groups, and of course, many Buffalo Music Hall of Fame inductees. Now, let's send it back to our host, Janice Mitchell.
Thank you, Tom. The word community is, without question, central to human experience. Our next three inductees into the Buffalo Music Hall of Fame, class of 2021, have touched the lives of so many people in so many ways. Richie Merlot was an award-winning vocalist, MC, crooner, and jazz trumpeter who played alongside local and international jazz greats in Western New York. Maria Sebastian is a world-class and versatile indie singer-songwriter who has won multiple awards, both locally and globally. Rick James' Stone City Family is a Grammy Award-winning group that served as the late funk icon's exclusive recording and touring band, and considered by many to be one of the greatest live performing funk rock bands ever to hit a stage.
A crooner and jazz trumpeter, Richie Merlot was featured in the Buffalo area's leading nightclubs. In the 1960s, he was vocalist and MC for appearances by the major stars of the day. He later played alongside local jazz greats, including saxophonist Bobby Militello.
Richie was an extremely talented guy. My interaction was only for about 2 years with Richie at this point in time. When I was younger, Richie used to be out in the clubs playing and doing things, and I would catch him there. And he would be singing and all this kind of stuff, and it was like, you got to realize, the kids nowadays have no idea what show business was. They don't know what that is. Richie was the epitome of understanding what show business was, so that you could contextually put it into what you're doing when you're playing jazz.
Pianist George Caldwell talks about meeting Richie alongside Hall of Famer Joey Giambra.
And, my wife, it was a Sunday, and Joey Giambra's band was playing there, and Richie used to sing with him. So I went over and she introduced me to Joey, and Richie was singing with him, and Joey called me up to sit in with him, so I sat in on a couple of tunes, and I played a tune with Richie. I remember thinking, wow, this guy is like truly in his heart, the old school of the guys in Vegas, you know, with the collars and the, you know, but his manner was not affected. It just was who he was, and he expressed himself through that.
Merlot, Militello, Caldwell, and drummer Lou Marino for Buffalo Bop, which captured an Art Voice Best Jazz Act Award.
Richie had, again, that melodic sense that is Buffalo. It wasn't about lots of chops. It was about the right notes, playing the right kind of stuff. And at points, he was a choppy player when he was younger. He was a very choppy player, which means he has a good execution. He can play licks fast and do all kinds of stuff. But when he sang, it was about the groove.
Richie toured extensively from Toronto to Miami, then went to Los Angeles and joined the band of Bobby Boris Pickett of Monster Mash fame. He had a 3-year run in Las Vegas at the Sands Hotel before returning home to play in top Western New York clubs.
Richie is another person who was a gentle soul. He was very, as artists, I think artists in general are their own worst critics, you know. And so he was self-effacing and didn't think his talent was that great, although he was a great singer, a great trumpet player, and a great guy.
Merlot was MC at McVann's, The Stage Door, Mr. Anthony's, the Williamsville Inn, Salvatore's, and Elmwood Lounge.
Richie was a true talent. He was an absolute true talent. He had, and he was extremely humble about it too. He never boasted of his talent. He just simply was one, which is the right way to be. And playing with him was a ball.
Award-winning and versatile singer-songwriter, Maria Sebastian has won 12 Nightlife Music Awards, a People's Choice Award, Buffalo Spree Album of the Year, and 3 Global Music Awards before becoming a Buffalo Music Hall of Fame inductee.
To be in the Hall of Fame, I always thought about what it would take to get there and wondered if it required any relocating or that, sometimes you have to make sure that you have national, or international credits, and I was somehow able to stack a couple similar accolades, I guess you could say, up just by working with people out of town and recording in other places. I won some Global Music Awards, which are nice, and so yeah, I found a way to get there, and while still staying here. Sometimes you got to leave in order to get those kinds of awards.
Maria's credits include performing with 10,000 Maniacs and opening for legendary artists such as Richie Havens, Gin Blossoms, Collective Soul, Eddie Money, and Roger McGuinn of the Byrds.
Yeah, I was playing for Music is Art in the middle of the Galleria Mall, and this woman came up to me and said, my husband and I just love what you just did. You should play a show with him sometime. And so, I'm packing up at the same time she's talking, and he had microphone recommendations for my preamp or for my guitar, and so she gave me a card, and he wrote what kind of microphone I should be using on the back of it. And, thanks, and nice to meet you, and I did not know the name Roger McGuinn, and so a lot of my friends were just kind of patting me on the head after that. She didn't know who he was. But yes, it turned into a really nice friendship over a couple years or so. I played 8 shows opening for him in various venues on the East Coast and part of the Midwest as well. It was fun while it lasted. His agent or manager decided that it should be an evening with Roger McGuinn, so a lot of us lucky ones who got to open for him multiple times did not get that show anymore. But I'm very grateful for the opportunity while I had it with him.
She also wrote and recorded with Red Hot Chili Peppers guitarist Jack Sherman and Hall of Fame drummer Gary Malibur, creating a project called In From the Cold.
We started assembling some material, and then I ran that by Robbie Konikoff over at Audio Magic, and I said, gee, Robbie, you got some people you've recorded I could listen to, and he did, and he sent them out to me, and I immediately went right to Maria's voice. I thought there was something very special in that, although I didn't know her fully as a person, who that was, but I just went with the voice, and I said, okay. Let's go back there. I know my hometown very well. Let's go back there and assemble some material and see if Maria wants to jump in. And we can all be very democratic on the writing, and let's see if we can go at it. And that's exactly what we did.
In her other recorded work with artists such as Alan Kroll, Terry Buchwald, and Doug Yeomans, her versatility has served her well.
She's not at all limited as a musician. She can do the pop thing, and her songs are wonderful, singer-songwriter. And she does the Great American Songbook, jazz. So she's very talented in many respects. She bridges many gaps, in the genres. And just a wonderful performer, wonderful vocalist.
Maria has also excelled as an educator, winning a Master Teacher Award in 2011. And an Adjunct of the Year honor at NCCC.
Yeah, I love teaching writing. I find if I'm teaching literature that, because otherwise I teach a lot of composition and that, but when I'm teaching the literature stuff, it just reminds me of the importance of telling a story. I need to be reminded of that.
It came from our soul and probably from our DNA.
Music always lived in the Johnson home and in the neighborhood where Rick James grew up. With a bunch of boys from Buffalo, Rick could make that music magic.
Now, we grew up together. We were all, you know, musicians in the projects. We practiced and we knew what we, you know, sounded like. But when I heard them play behind Rick, I never heard them sound better. It was, I mean, amazing.
Rick's own family and his Stone City family say he was a guy of many talents and surprises. Funny, athletic, even forming a basketball team with bandmates.
And Rick, you know, used to score like 30 points a game. He's like, this guy can really play, man. He's pretty good.
A guy who loved to entertain and who could hold his own wherever he went.
He did not graduate from high school, but he could talk to you about the Boer War. He could talk to you about history of European, you know, history of the Far East. He was an avid reader.
It was his passion for music that ignited all his senses. A strong business acumen, drive, and creativity. Playing with people like Neil Young, he had a passion for rock and roll, but over time developed the sound known as punk funk. He introduced it to Berry Gordy while writing for acclaimed artists like The Temptations and Smokey Robinson. Rick James helped to save what was by that time a fledgling Motown.
So Rick comes in with a complete different sound. And the truth of the matter is we saved Motown. We saved it with Rick and the groups that we had, the Mary Jane Girls.
Still, it took music outlets like MTV time to catch up.
That change in MTV brought about changes that we feel today because the change brought about the hip-hop revolution. They would have never been seen had videos and that been stopped. It hurt us because they never played us.
Rick James forced MTV and the music industry as a whole to change, to accept and celebrate black artists, the music. And in so doing, he helped to revolutionize American culture.
But that is a massive move to that changed not only the entertainment industry, but it changed society.
It was as if he understood the bigger picture, the impact on that society as a whole.
It wasn't like Rick created braids, but he was affected by seeing what it meant to him.
And he wanted his Stone City family to do the same. Friends, bandmates call him a genius, tenacious. Rick and his band made appearances on iconic shows like Saturday Night Live and performed all over the world. Rick James is an American music and Grammy Award winner. His records sold millions, and songs like Super Freak, performed with the Stone City Band, climbed the Billboard charts. Still, through all his successes, Rick never forgot where he came from.
His whole philosophy was that he was going to use people from Buffalo. These guys are as good as anybody anywhere, period. So you go with the best. And I'll tell you, Rick, if you weren't the best, Rick wouldn't have you around long. So these guys, you know, passed the test of time.
You know, a community of people that, I know that guy over there, that's the keyboard player. We grew up together. I know that guy right here. That's Head. That's Rick's brother. We went to school together. You know, so it was like that kind of a thing.
Appreciative of his hometown and the people in it. Generous with his time and his talents, Rick James was a teacher. Along with his Stone City family, created a sound and a movement as unique as their Buffalo bond.
Hey, where my brother's at? Where my brother's at? Yeah.
On the other side of the break, a tribute to some of the great local musicians we've lost.
We are so appreciative for their talent and the magic of music they have delivered into all of our lives.
As we wrap up the 2021 Buffalo Music Hall of Fame induction, we want to congratulate all of this year's inductees.
If you'd like more information or are able to donate, just go to our website, buffalomusichalloffame.org.